those records. So in other words, we say we want to improve our gross by 10%. If we increase our gross by 10%, you're going to share in that. And we say, okay, go. And we just expect the magic to happen. Well, the incentive's there, but we've got to give our team the tools they need to succeed. So if we're asking about getting more money, getting more students, doing more marketing, what tools do they need to help us reach our goals so, again, they can reach their bonus or their incentives? So there's a lot of things. Salaries increase on gross, and it's things are attainable with increasing levels of effort. So in other words, if we want to increase our gross, I know we can do if we get a whole team putting more effort either in sales, marketing, or whatsoever. But again, we have to give them specific tools. We have to train on specific tools. So first, we know what drives people. Again, I know I'm being redundant, but what drives people in this case is financial incentives. If people know that if they work harder, they're going to make more money, we're usually going to get their cooperation. So now we want to give them the tools they need to help us succeed. So one of the things that's often missing is physical tools. So physical tools would be like invitations. They could be gift cards. They could be business cards, VIP cards, rack cards. But they need physical tools. We just can't say, okay, go out in the community, shake a lot of hands, talk to people, and get me some appointments. Well, we're going to get a certain amount of people that can do that, but most people need a tool. We're working with a team just a couple weeks ago, and there's one gentleman. He was a little bit shy about going out and actually talking to people. And I said, well, imagine you're in line at Starbucks. You're waiting for a cup of coffee. You're ready to order a cup of coffee. Someone's standing next to you. How would you introduce yourself or talk to that person about introducing him to the martial arts program? And he, all of a sudden, he got stumped. It seems like it'd be a very easy thing, but sometimes it's a difficult thing. You know, you're waiting for your coffee. Someone's next to you. You haven't started a conversation. Maybe someone's looking at their cell phone. So how do you break into that and actually introduce yourself? And I said, the thing is to be authentic. And the thing is just be honest and tell them what you're doing. Hey, my name's Greg Silva. I own the martial arts school at the end of the plaza. I was out marketing my school today, and I would like to give you this. And you hold out some type of VIP card, some type of invitation. Person grabs a card, and you tell them exactly what's on the card. Hey, that card happens to be good for a free month of martial arts. Again, we're trying to keep everyone safe in our community. Fitness is part of our program, and, of course, self-defense is part of our program. So having some type of tool really helps. It makes it a lot easier to have an icebreaker than just going up and starting a conversation. Now, when we do referrals like that, or VIPs, whatever you want to call that, it's really important that we practice inside the school. So if we're training our team and we expect them to go out and do a lot of conversations, we should practice. Now, again, give them some type of script. Best thing is just explain what you're doing. Imagine you're out there pumping gas and someone else is pumping gas on the other side of the pump and you're not talking about anything and how you're going to break into conversation. And you just talk to the person, hey, my name is Greg Silva. You know, I own a martial arts school in town. We have a great summer program. I'd like to give you a card for a free trial lesson. Okay, now we're going to practice that back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Maybe we go out with our team and we do it. They just watch so they know it's possible. People aren't going to chop our head off because we're talking to a stranger. It's actually pretty easy to do. So you want to make sure your PDR, which stands for practice, drill, and rehearse. We also want to talk to our team about add-ons. You know, we have a lot of students. You know, I'm looking at Sal Cavento walking, and one of his schools has over 300 students. Well, that's 300 students. Out of those 300 students, how many siblings, how many moms, how many dads, how many grandparents? I mean, each family probably has 6 to 8 people that they could add on. It may not be immediate family, but if you have a young student, now you've got both parents. Both parents have parents, so now they have grandparents, so you got 6 extra people. Well, after we're teaching that student and we're talking to them, we're talking to the family, it's really easy to get in a conversation with the dad and say, hey, you look like you're pretty in good shape. What do you do to exercise? The guy goes, oh, I don't really do anything right now. Hey, well, do you ever think about taking martial arts with your child? I mean, how many sports can you actually do and participate with your child? I mean, you want to be that superhero in your child's life. you really should start by setting that example. I'd love to have you part of our program. In fact, I'd like to have you come in, try a couple classes, just tell me what you think. So now we're teaching them how to create a conversation with a parent, with a grandparent, and we're doing family add-ons. So again, we're talking to, again, Sal Cavento. He's out there walking 300 students. You know, if he starts thinking of the parents, the grandparents, that's 1,800 more people. Out of those 1,800, there's got to be 25 or 30, you know, out of 1,800 that he can add on as a family member. Make sure when we prospect, who is a likely prospect when we're out in the community? I was at a bank the other day, and I happened to have one of my old vintage East-West Karate t-shirts on, and there's happens to be a school in that our area that's called East-West Karate, and the girl just starts saying, hey, you from East-West Karate down in Lake Worth? I don't know, this is my vintage t-shirt from Coral Springs, but that person mentioned that school. I go, do you ever take lessons at that school? She goes, no, I never took lessons there, but it's on my way home. Well, that'd be a perfect time if you had a VIP pass to talk to that person. I was just telling Mr. Del Castillo, I was at church yesterday, and I'm in a small group. It would be really easy for me to start talking in that group shortly and meeting people and just passing out my guest pass. So everyone you meet is prospective new student in your school. You really don't know what's happening in their life. But if they know about your school, they've met you, you've built a little rapport with them, if it ever comes time where they're going to want to do martial arts, they're going to remember you and remember your school. So everyone you meet's a prospect. Make sure you get those VIP passes, at least the idea of martial arts training in their head. This happens to be June. June is graduation. If I have a team of instructors and I say, okay, it'd be really, really cool if we called all our ex-students. Tell them that this graduation, I know you're not training here at the school, but a lot of your friends are still training. And a lot of those people coming to graduation. It would be totally awesome if you showed up at graduation just to support them. You were training for like 6 to 8 months. I know you built up some friendships. I'd love to have your graduation. Not talking about enrollments, not talking about any special. I'm giving my staff the tools that they could do to get a person back in the school. Once a person gets back in the school, now we can get some type of conversation going and invite them in for a small trial program or maybe offer them some free time if they get a started back in the martial arts. But the important thing is to just get them back into the school for the graduation. And I guess the real important thing is I'm teaching my staff what they need to do to make contacts, how they can help bring people back to the school, how we can increase their student enrollment. When we do that, we increase the gross, and now I'm showing them how that they can earn their bonus. Promotional boosts. Promotional boosts just work great. Again, this is one of those things that if you train your staff, they can actually get an incentive on promotional boosts. When I had the school in Mesa, Arizona a couple years back, I had a young lady that loved to do promotional boosts. Well, we used to do them on Wednesdays. We'd go to restaurants where they had kids eat free. A lot of parents would go there with their kids. We would set up a booth between like 4 and 7 o'clock. And she would sell our trial program. We had a poster. It said, trial program, $29.95. Today, only $9.95. So she would sell a two-lesson trial program for $10. She got to keep all the $10. I paid her to run the promotion booth. I don't know what she was getting paid, maybe $12 an hour or whatever she did. And every time she made an appointment, she also got to keep that $10. So she got, you know, 4 people to do the trial program in those few hours. She would make, you know, an extra $40 over her pay. She absolutely loved it. Just gave her the opportunity to make more money. A lot of your staff's thinking, you know, I'd really like to buy a new car. I'd really like to do this. I need some extra money. Well, you're showing them how they can earn some extra money and at the same time build up your school. Events. Events at your school are really important because now I have a reason to invite someone to come in. So if we're doing an event this weekend and it's on for summer safety and it's bully-proof the kids during summer. A lot of people think, well, they're not in school, they're not going to get bullied. Well, They may get bullied more in summertime because they may be out with just other kids and the teacher's not around. They could be at the playground and there's no teacher there to break things up. So it's still really important that kids learn how to handle themselves in bully situations. Well, if I know I'm having that event on this Saturday, now I train my team. Hey, when you're out and about and you start seeing kids, just make sure that you talk to the parents and invite the parents and the child into our free community event. So having an event is just a reason for the team to go out, team to talk to people. Maybe you're going out to a summer camp and you're doing a little martial arts presentation at a summer camp. You invite everyone back into your school and now they can come in and do a bulletproof class. Another thing we can do for events is charged events. This isn't just for prospecting. This is just getting more income. So if you're going to do you're not into maybe summer camps, but you want to do a day camp. So you're doing a Pokemon day camp and you're charging $50 for that one day next week. And now your staff is really talking to all the students. You got to be here at camp. This is going to be the coolest day camp you've ever been to. So now the whole team's talking to the students. They're really excited. They're getting more students there. They know the importance that students come to event because this is that social atmosphere. You're building up the culture of your school. At the same time, everyone's paying for this event. So if you're kind of splitting some of this revenue between your team, having an event is a way for them to earn some extra income. This is a month for graduation. One of the things a lot of students need before graduation is private classes, either to look really good at their curriculum. Maybe it's just for getting the required number of classes. They missed a few classes because of school letting out, things like that. Now you have graduation come up. They need a couple extra classes so they can make those classes up with private classes. But what I'm really trying to give you is another tool for your staff to increase their income. So if they're getting a percentage of the gross, and all of a sudden now you're selling 50 private classes in the month of June, your gross is definitely going to go up. So teaching your instructors to recommend parents that, hey, your child's coming up for graduation. I think it would really help if he took a private class. We have private classes available these days. So selling private classes and recommending private classes, even your front end person. You know, and she's talking to other parents, and you're talking to the parent and go, is your child ready for graduation? I think so. He's a little bit rusty at something. Well, if he's a little bit rusty, we can send him for a private class so we can make sure that, you know, he's all polished up and ready to go when it comes to graduation. Again, the important thing is training the team where everyone's recommending private classes. So there's one thing in saying we've got to raise the gross. The other thing in training your team on all aspects of raising the gross. So it's either getting new students, it's getting renewals, it's getting them to add on programs, it's generating money through either birthday parties or events, and again, pro shop. Now, kids grow out of uniforms. They need extra t-shirts for summertime. So having your instructors and your front end office people recommend that they get new equipment, well, that adds to pro shop sales, which adds to your gross. And again, if your team is getting paid for incentives, and that incentive is a portion of the gross, we're teaching them how to improve that. If you don't want to do all that work, you can always just buy your students too. I always think about this. We say, buy your students. Well, you know, I think a lot of you are familiar with William Pierce. William Pierce does a lot of marketing. He does a lot of Facebook ads. He spends probably about $2,500 a month on Facebook ads because he doesn't like doing all this stuff. So if you don't like all this stuff and you still want students, you still can do it. One, you're investing in people, and the other, you're investing your money into some marketing, but it can be done both ways. So I don't want you to think it's all suffering and hard work if you just want to buy students instead. Next thing I just want to talk about a little is our director of first impressions. That's probably one of the most important positions in your school. Director of first impressions is the person who's behind the counter. And when someone walks into your school, this is the first impression. So your director could be a young woman. It could be one of the moms you hired behind the counters. It could be one of the instructors. In the case of the Baker School in Arizona, it's John Baker. He's one of the head instructors. He's also the director of first impressions. He's behind the front counter. He just has a great outgoing personality. Well, that's an important person. Everyone coming into that school is saying hi to this person. This person should really be outgoing. This person be making sure they're not just outgoing, but they're talking, they're learning about people, they're getting some conversations going. And we also want to make sure that the goals of the school, they're really lined up with my director of first impressions. So I think it's probably, if I had to hire one person in the school and it's okay, I'm going to hire a instructor or I'm going to hire a director of first impressions, I would hire a director of first impressions. I would teach a little harder myself, but this is a really important position because this person's really making sure that all attendance is taken care of. This person is making sure that if I have an event, everyone that walks in the door after they say hello, hey, how you doing? We're asking them if they're coming to the event. If they're not coming to the event, we make sure we persuade them to come to the event. They're signing up in the sign-up sheet. They're making sure that if you're coming to an event, now you know that it's really important to bring a guest. And the reason this is so important, not just for the finances, again, we're building the culture of the school. And when we do events like this, relationships are made between students. Students become best friends. When they have these relationships, it's like glue as far as membership in your school. It's really easy to quit karate. It's very hard to quit a relationship. When students are having fun and they're training together, they're less likely to just up and leave. Make sure that director of first impressions knows all about the retail items, what equipment the students need for each type of class. Make sure that when people come in, they're looking at their uniform. When kids start outgrowing a uniform, they should be buying at least one uniform a year because the way kids grow. If they see that they have some gear that doesn't fit, they're recommending new gear. If you have something new that came in, like a new t-shirt design, they're recommending the t-shirt design. So it's really important that you put these items on the wall or in your case, but at the same time, make sure this director of first impressions is talking to people about these retail items. A lot of kids, like the weapons they teach. I was just talking to Melanie. She has her students come in and they get a new weapon every cycle. So every 3 months they're changing weapons. Well, you can have an inexpensive weapon. And then there's some kids that want to have a nicer weapon. And there's some kids that just want to have that coolest bow staff possible. So make sure you have a good selection of weapons. And again, your director of first impression knows all about these. They know the difference in them. They know the benefits of each one, and they're going to recommend them to the students. This director of first impression should always have a list. Again, this is really easy with the new feature that Rainmaker just put out last week that tells you all about the students that walk in the door. And so if you're a director of first impressions has their iPad out and someone comes in, it's their birthday, it's going to notify right away that David just signed in today and today's his birthday. So now we make sure we pass that on to the instructor and they know everything about everyone that comes in and they're going to be the first one to know by talking to the parents if there's any challenges. So it's really important that you sit down with your director of first impressions, your friend and office person, and go over any concerns that may come up. So that's my take on this. And again, I know this isn't brand new for a lot of people, but it's really important that we're reminded of certain things because sometimes we kind of take this position for granted. They're at the front door, they've been doing good. But anytime we can talk and we can talk about the importance of this job, and how this person can help our school and help the students by being a little more proactive, we're going to get some better results. I got something very cool today. I don't know if you saw, but when I used to go on vacation, I used to actually sit down and handwrite a postcard to all my students. And this was way back in Connecticut. And if I, at that time, I had like 300 students, so I'd go on vacation. I had my kids at the time, so the kids would go to bed early. I would sit up and I would handwrite a postcard to every single student. And I got it from Tom Hopkins, who was kind of my mentor in sales. He goes, just write this, needed a rest, thought of you. So you could take that one or two ways, you know, because of you, I needed a rest, or I was taking a rest and I just happened to think of you. But I used to handwrite those postcards. Well, one of my students, Colin Campbell, he was a youngster, probably 10, 12 years old back in 87. Now he works in Washington. He's a lobbyist. I guess he's got a really, really important job. He sent me a picture of a postcard that I sent him in 1987 today. And I recognized it right away because it was a lodge that I always go to in Lake George, New York. But you just never can tell. I don't know why this guy kept that all that time, but he still had it. So, you know, all those things are relationships. And it's really neat because he had changed his first name. It's not Colin anymore. I forget what he changed it to. But I saw his picture on Facebook, and I said, hey, remember me? And he looks totally, totally different now. And he goes, do you remember me? I go, I don't remember you. I remember your brother. I remember you're on the demo team. I remember we just – and he just couldn't believe it. And then we started this relationship again. But it just shows you how long some of those relationships have in the just importance you have in people's lives. You don't even know it just by something small that you did. I saw that on the web today, too, from Paul Garcia. You know, it's the small things that really make the big difference. Do we have any comments or questions? I know we have Wolfpack Martial Arts is still in the contest for the 100 Students 100 Days. And Sal Convento and our leader, Stephen DeCastell, I don't know if he's still the leader, but I'm going to post that up. I imagine I think he's up to 38 students. So he is ahead of the game right now. He's doing more than a student a day. So that's totally awesome. Okay, everyone, tomorrow we are talking on this meeting with Steve Butts. Steve Butts, I think, I believe he has the most successful after-school program in the country. Last month he did $250,000. That was his gross in 1 month. He's got 1,000 students, 500 are after-schoolers. They do martial arts, they do gymnastics, they do cheer. He does everything in his school, really, really solid. He's in Milton, Florida. Just Google Milton, Florida if you just want to compare his demographics to your demographics. Just check out how many people live in Milton and then just imagine what he's doing. He's got three schools in that area, again, 500 total students. I think it's totally amazing that someone could have a go from martial arts school owner to multi-school owner to a multi-disciplined school owner in grossing $250,000 a month. That's totally amazing. I also came out with a new program. When I tell people it's a combination of martial arts and gymnastics, go, oh, must be hyper. It's not hyper. He uses a lot of equipment that he does in cheer, a lot of the equipment that he does in gymnastics, and he does it with his martial arts students. It's called Ninja Nation. It's just a great program, and so he's going to talk a little bit about that tomorrow also. In fact, he was featured on the cover of MA Success about 3 months ago, and he was on the cover of that. So Steve Butts, very, very cool guy. Besides doing this, he also races motorcycles. He's got some type of top drag bike, I don't know, 200 miles an hour, I don't know, crazy. But he does that on the weekends. So very, very cool person. So I'll see you tomorrow. I'll put a recording of this on the web today and the recording of tomorrow's. Have a great day. Make a difference, guys.
Hoo-ah. Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.